مولاي صل وسلم دائما أبدا على حبيبك خير الخلق كلهم. مولاي صل وسلم دائما أبدا على حبيبك خير الخلق كلهم.
محمد سيد الكونين والثقلين.
محمد سيد الكونين والثقلين.
محمد سيد الكونين والثقلين والفارقين من عرب ومن عجم.
مولاي صل وسلم دائما أبدا على حبيبك خير الخلق كلهم. مولاي صل وسلم دائما أبدا على حبيبك خير الخلق كلهم.
هو الحبيب الذي ترجى شفاعته. شفاعته لكل هول من الأهوال مقتحم.
مولاي صل وسلم دائما أبدا على حبيبك خير الخلق كلهم. مولاي صل وسلم دائما أبدا على حبيبك خير الخلق كلهم.
مولاي صل
دائما أبدا
على حبيبك
خير خلق الله
كله.
مولاي صل وسلم دائما أبدا على حبيبك خير الخلق كله. مولاي صل وسلم دائما
عثمان ذي الكرم.
مولاي صل وسلم دائما أبدا على حبيبك خير الخلق كلهم. مولاي صل وسلم دائما أبدا على حبيبك خير الخلق كلهم.
يا ربي بلغ مقاصدنا.
يا ربي بالمصطفى بلغ مقاصدنا. يا ربي بالمصطفى بلغ مقاصدنا.
واغفر لنا ما مضى يا واسع الكرم.
مولاي صل
الرحيم. الحمد لله وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. All praise is due to God, Lord of all beings, the all-merciful, the compassionate, Master of the Day of Judgment. You alone we worship, and from you alone we seek help. Guide us on the straight path, the path of those whom you have given your bounties, not the path of those who deserve your anger, and neither those who have gone astray. I welcome you all for the second episode in the lecture series, Know This Man, the Life of Muhammad. I welcome you all with the greeting of Islam. May the peace, mercy, and blessings of Almighty God be with each and every one of you. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Last week, we came across a great name, and some innocently came to me after the presentation, and as they call me, Am, which means uncle, in the Arab culture, anyone who's older than you, you refer to them as uncle. And in Arabic, as I said, it's Ammu. So they said, Ammu Munir, we thought that you were going to talk about the life of Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, peace be upon him. But instead you were talking about Prophet Ibrahim, Abraham. And then you mentioned his son, Ishmael, Ismail. But why? And I told them that for us to understand the life of Muhammad, we have to understand the life of Ibrahim and that of Ismail, even though by now you know that if I say Ismail or Ishmael, Ibrahim or Abraham, it's the same thing. So we have to understand that in order for us to understand that Muhammad, peace be upon him, did not come in a vacuum. Muhammad did not come separated from Jesus or Isa in the Quranic language, did not come separated from Isaac or Jacob or Yusuf, Joseph or Moses. All of them made a family that preached the same thing, and that is the worship and love of the same God. That in Arabic happened to be called, or referred to, I should say, Allah. Allah is the Arabic for God. The same as Dieu is the French for God. The same thing. Yet, one thing about the Arabic term, it doesn't have a plural. God in English can be gods. But Allah in Arabic doesn't have a plural. It doesn't exist. And because Islam stresses the oneness of God, we tend to use Allah. So from there on, I'll be using God and Allah exchangeably. Ibrahim was born in a little town in southern Iraq called Ur. And there, he lived for some time, then he moved a little bit north until he got to a place called Harran. Today, those who like geography can look in the map. In southern Turkey, there is a town called Urfa. Urfa is Harran. That's where Prophet Ibrahim moved after he was placed in the fire as a punishment for breaking down the idol gods that the people used to worship, and he left with his life and went to Harran. From there, he went to Aleppo in southern Syria, and then from there, he went down to Palestine, and it was a time of a drought. He went west to Egypt,
And in Egypt, something very dangerous happened where the Pharaoh wanted to exercise his authority. He wanted to take Sarah, the wife of Abraham, into his harem, so to speak. But Abraham was very quick in saying that Sarah was his sister and it was his duty to actually protect her honor. The Pharaoh didn't have much of argument to make, so he felt bad and he let go of Abraham and his wife Sarah. And by the way, he had his nephew Lot with him, Lot, and his wife as well. And as a sign of remorse, he gave them a slave. Some say it was the daughter of Pharaoh, God knows, but her name was Hagar. And Hagar went back with Abraham, and then they settled. Abraham, Sarah, Hagar settled in Beersheba, or Be'er Seba, and Lot and his wife went to the southern tip of the Dead Sea, that is referred to as the Lake of Lut, Bahirat Lut, and they settled in that place. So the Almighty God talks about Pharaoh and how he really considered himself a divinity, so to speak. So we read in the Quran, فَالْيَوْمَ نُنَجِّيكَ بِبَدَنِكَ لِتَكُونَ لِمَنْ خَلْفَكَ آيَةً. And Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, did not really see a mummy of Pharaoh that preserved the body of Pharaoh, even though he died. But the Quran said it very clearly, فَالْيَوْمَ نُنَجِّيكَ بِبَدَنِكَ. Today, we will preserve your body so that you will be a sign for those who will come after you, that when they hear about what Pharaoh did, they will see the body of Pharaoh. And this is a mummy of Pharaoh preserved for all of us to see. This is the Pharaoh, Fir'aun, that he is the second Ramses, Ramses Athani. So this is, by the way, we can now move back to the map. Now, Ibrahim, settling in Beersheba, was longing for a son or daughter. He was 83 years old, and he wanted someone that can call him dad. He didn't. The Almighty God was having a divine scenario being prepared. So he let Sarah feel adequate to suggest to her husband to get married to Hagar. And Ibrahim got married to Hagar, and she bore a child, born Ismail. Ishmael, Sarah felt that, why couldn't I have given my husband a son like Hagar did? So she asked Ibrahim to take Hagar and her son Ismail away. And Ibrahim, away where? He didn't know the land. The Almighty God inspired him to move south. So he moved to an arid desert landscape where, when he arrived in this tip here, there was nothing, absolutely nothing. He stopped there, and he said to Hagar and her son Ishmael that I'm gonna leave you here. And they looked around each other. There was nothing. بِوَادٍ غَيْرِ ذِي زَرَعٍ. That there's absolutely no plantation, no vegetation, nothing to support life. But Hagar looked at her husband that she trusted so much, and she said to him, Allahu amaraka bihada, did the Almighty order you to leave us here? He said, yes. So she said to him, فَلَنْ يَكِلَنَ اللَّهُ لِأَحَدٍ. God will not forsake us. He will not leave us to danger. And they stayed there. And it so happened that the Almighty God led Abraham to the site of the first house of worship that Adam had built upon his descent to earth. And that was the Kaaba. And God Almighty said to Abraham, you stay here because this is the site. He didn't know at that time, by the way. He said, you stay here. وَإِذْ بَوَّأْنَا لِإِبْرَاهِيمَ مَكَانَ الْبَيْتِ. We just inspired him that you leave your family in this site that later on will be a center of sorts. So Ibrahim led them there. They stayed. They had a little bit of food, a little bit of water to drink. After a few days, everything was gone. No vegetation, nothing. And the mother was frantic. She panicked, not for herself, for her baby, who wanted to drink. She could feed him, but that wasn't enough. She wanted water, she wanted something to sustain his life. So she went to a hill called As-Safa. She thought that she could look and scan the horizon. Maybe she can see something there. She didn't. She ran down and went up another hill on the other side called Al-Marwa. She didn't see anything. She repeated that until finally she looked close to where her son was and she thought it was a mirage of sorts because it looked like water. So she wanted to believe that it was water. She came down, and yes, it was. It was the water of Zamzam. And if we look at the next slide, you know, just we could see actually that this is the water of Zamzam gushing out from the earth. And we can see it here. Geologists actually say we don't know where it's coming from. They examined the earth under Zamzam and they said that according to what we know, this earth does not hold water. Where is it coming from? Only God knows. It had to be in that place because this is part of the miracle that will demonstrate to humanity that God is not affected by the cause-effect relationship. God says to something be, and it becomes. So this is Zamzam that really supported the life there. Now, from southern Arabia in Yemen, remember we said last time that Arabia is made of five different places. The southern tip is that of Yemen, a mountainous region. There, a tribe, an Arabian tribe, its members spoke Arabic, beautiful Arabic, moved up. That was called Jurhum. And they arrived at that time in the vicinity where Hagar and her son were there. And they wanted to settle in that area. They asked permission. Look at this. Look how, you know, sometimes things pass without us dwelling on certain that they could have actually forced Hagar to accept that they are going to start a little village around her. But they asked her permission. Would you allow us to settle in that vicinity, asking a woman that had no weapon, that had nothing. They could have, but they didn't. And this shows the mannerism of the Arabs in those days, how they dealt with each other. So she said yes, and they settled there. And Ismail grew up in that community, knowing those people. And he learned two languages. The language that his father Abraham taught him and the language of the Arabs of Jurhum. He spoke Hebrew and Arabic and he spoke them fluently. And Abraham used to go between Palestine and Mecca. Palestine and Mecca. And according to historical research, we know that he made the trip between Palestine and Mecca 4 times. The first time he came was answering a dream that prophets and messengers knew was communication from the Almighty God. God communicated a test to Ibrahim. He wanted to test him, so he sent a communication as he was sleeping and said, Abraham, you are to go and sacrifice your love. What's my love? You waited 83 years for a son or daughter. I gave you a son or daughter. You loved your son or daughter as you're supposed to. So much. But Abraham had a love more than that of his son. And the Almighty God wanted to give a gift to Ibrahim to make him realize the order of love in his heart. He wanted to show him that he was such a perfect human being that he was able to put things in the proper perspective. Nowadays, many of us are not capable to discover the order of love in their hearts. Many may love their business more than their families. They may love money more than they love their health. They love, they are unable to really discern where that list of priority lies. But Abraham put things in the proper perspective and God wanted to show him. So he said to him, Abraham, do the undoable. Some people think of it as a sign of cruelty from God. How could God? No, it wasn't. God wanted to show Abraham that he will do anything that God will ask him, even the undoable. Even the undoable. So he said to him, Abraham, go and sacrifice your son Ishmael. And this is where the difference between the Christian theology and the Islamic belief, which is incorporated in the Quran, because we do believe that the Quran is the literal word of God. And in the Quran, the suggestion in a chapter surah called As-Saffat is that the Almighty God asked Abraham to sacrifice his son. It doesn't mention him by name, by the way. It doesn't say Ishmael. And then after those ayat, it talks about وَوَهَبْنَا لَهُ إِسْحَاقَ وَيَعْقُوبَ. After that, it talks about we gave Abraham later Isaac and then Jacob, which suggests that God the Almighty asked Abraham to sacrifice Ishmael. So Abraham came for the first time back to Mecca from Palestine for him to sacrifice his son in Mecca after seeing the dream 3 times. So when he arrived there, he didn't want to say to Hagar, give me your son, I'm going to sacrifice him. Do you think that the mother will just say, okay, take him, he's yours, do anything you want to do? No. He had to really do it in a tactful manner. Perhaps later he could explain to her. So she said, okay, take him on a trip to the countryside. And the tradition says that Ishmael was 13 years of age at that time. So he went with him. And then when they reached far from where Mecca was, and far, by the way, is where Mina today. You know, when Muslims go for Hajj, they go to Mecca, they go to Arafat, they go to Mina, they go to Muzdalifa. Where Mina is where Abraham reached for him to sacrifice his son, Ishmael. So he said to Ishmael, يَا بُنَيَّ إِنِّي أَرَى فِي الْمَنَامِ أَنِّي أَذْبَحُكَ فَانْظُرْ مَاذَا تَرَى. Look at this lesson. You know, the father who is 96 years old now, his son is 13 years old, he is consulting with him concerning something that a 13 years old would look with empty eyes at his father saying, what? You want to kill me? Are you crazy? And would run away from him. But look at this. God the Almighty, who is establishing lessons for parents and children in parenting and in proper relationship with the father, with the parents, established the ultimate extreme example that we don't expect anybody to go through today. So don't ever expect that this will happen again. I hope not. Now, so Abraham came to his son and he said, يَا بُنَيَّ إِنِّي أَرَى فِي الْمَنَامِ أَنِّي أَذْبَحُكَ فَانْظُرْ مَاذَا تَرَى. Oh my dear son, I am seeing in the dream that I am sacrificing you. Tell me, how do you feel about this? What would you say? قَالَ يَا أَبَتِ فَعَلْ مَا تُؤْمَرُ سَتَجِدُنِي إِنْ شَاءَ اللَّهُ مِنَ الصَّابِرِينَ. يَا أَبَتِ is like saying, Dad. He didn't say, يَا وَالِدِي. قَالَ يَا أَبَتِ, Dad, do whatever you are ordered by God to do. God willing, I will be patient in face of this difficulty. Look at this. And then it says that as Abraham was getting ready for this and tying the eyes, a blindfold around the, he didn't want him to see the sharpness of the knife. At that time, Satan